hear me well?
Yes.
Yep.
Praise the Lord. James chapter 5, verse 13, section in my Bible translation is called the prayer of faith. It says, is anyone among you suffering? Let him pray. Is anyone cheerful? Let him praise. Is anyone among you sick? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith will save the one who is sick, and the Lord will raise him up. And if he has committed sins, he will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person has great power as it is working. That's what I'm going to do here tonight. I'm going to confess my sins. I know that I have been gone for a while. And the reason for that is because I have a lot of stuff going on in my life right now, and I'm feeling overwhelmed. Mm-hmm. And when that happens, I shut down. And when I shut down, I hide. Mm-hmm. And, you know, not of the times that I have not been here have been for that. Others have been because Kelly and I have been going to where her family is and other things that have come up. But for the most part, that's what's going on. You know, I'm not one to ask for help a lot. Not because of I'm proud. It's more because of shame. I don't like to bother people. If I need something, I try to figure out a way of doing it on my own. And because of this, I haven't been praying like I should. I haven't been reading the word like I should. And right now, I feel this distance between me and God that I want to be gone. I've been asking him for a while to help me get out of this funk that I'm in. And I don't even know why it is, because everything in my life is good. But I think he gave me the answer this morning, because this morning I asked him to show me something that will help me remind myself of who I am in him, and how can I get out of this. And since today is July 6th, I said, well, I'm going to read Psalms chapter 6. And this is what it says. O Lord, rebuke me not in your anger, nor discipline me in your wrath. Be gracious to me, O Lord, for I am languishing. Heal me, O Lord, for my bones are troubled. My soul also is greatly troubled. But you, O Lord, how long? Turn, O Lord, deliver my life. Save me for the sake of your steadfast love. For in death there is no remembrance of you. In Sheol, who will give you praise? I am weary with my moaning. Every night I flood my bed with tears. I drench my couch with my weeping. My eye wastes away because of grief. It grows weak because of all my foes. Depart from me, all you workers of evil, for the Lord has heard the sound of my weeping. The Lord has heard my plea. The Lord accepts my prayer. All my enemies shall be ashamed and greatly troubled. They shall turn back and be put to shame in a moment. He's heard my cry. And every word that I speak to him, I know that he hears. And I know that I'm going to hear his voice again. And I know that this hole that I'm in right now is going to get filled, and I'm going to go back to walk in the valley, and it's all going to be good. And I know that you guys pray for me, and I love that, and I really appreciate that. And I know that he's listening to your prayers too, and I have to be here. I saw something on Facebook not too long ago that says that if people think that the reason why we come to church is because we're whole and we're perfect, they're wrong. We come here because we're broken,
right,
and we need each other, and we pray for each other.
Amen.
And that's when
Amen.
God gets glorified.
Amen.
And he manifests, and everything starts to move, and prayers are answered, and miracles happen, and people get healed, and all of those things. And I'm thankful for that, because those are little reminders that he gives me that he hasn't left my side.
Amen.
Right.
So I know that this is all going to go away. And that's the reason why I have been somewhat distant for a while. It's because I got into my little cocoon of solitude. But I'm coming out. And I'm thankful for that and for you. And I just want to give him praise and thank him. Any prayer requests or testimony? Yes.
I just want to give a praise report that I also am coming out of the funk in a distance from God.
Thank you, Jesus.
And he's taken back the land the enemy stole from me.
Last
9 years of my life. And I'm getting to know the Holy Spirit, who I've really never known all my Christian walk. And God has taken me into understanding the work of the Holy Spirit. And all day I shut the TV off, and just read and prayed and took notes. And now I'm here tonight. So I'm with you, brother. I'm here to receive. I'm here to praise. I'm here to praise the Lord.
Amen.
For you'll never leave us or forsake us.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Christ and I are one. So you and you are my beloved child, with whom I am well pleased.
Yes.
Woo.
Thank you, Jesus.
Woo.
He doesn't
Amen.
Leave us.
That's right.
That's right.
Glory.
Glory.
Glory. Yeah, thank you, Lord.
Glory.
Anyone else?
Thank you, Lord.
Tim.
Yes. We want to just thank the Lord for the opportunity to go visit our family in Southeast Iowa. It's always good to have that connection. And it's always good those moments for sometimes, like we had one of our granddaughters. We sat at the table and she came over. And she's 12 now. Started talking about her life, what she wants to be. You know, and I think that is such a touching moment that she wants to be a teacher. She wants to teach dance because she's working with the little kids. And she said that's what she feels that she should be doing. And I just thought, wow, at 12, to have that calling inside of you where she could inspire someone, I just thought, wow, that's so good. And then we got to see her other granddaughter, youngest one. It's just about a month old, a couple months. And I just thank the Lord for safe travel. And I thank the Lord for how he works with us every day.
Yes.
You know, I when I go to work in the morning, I turn on Christian radio, and then songs come on, and they just touch your heart for a day. And learning to lean, that song came on, and it's just, you know, finding more power than you ever dreamed. And when you just learn to lean on Jesus every single day, and learn to get closer to him and thank him, I still always think that the biggest thing that, as a believer, we need to do every day is learn to trust God more and more and believe him. Not believe all the stuff that swirls around us during the course of a day, but just to believe God. And I just want to thank the Lord for those opportunities.
Yeah, amen.
Happy birthday, by the way, Tim.
There it is.
Yes.
I just was thinking, I've been watching some of the Olympic trials. And people, you know, qualifying to go to the Olympics and whatnot. And I was really touched. There were several athletes who, like, won their race and just dropped to the ground. And you could hear them thanking Jesus and praising Jesus and worshiping God. And they didn't cut away the camera. They stayed with them. And when they interviewed them, I just was really touched that athletes from all over the country, you know, we're giving God the glory for their ability to, you know, compete and do the things that they do. It was encouraging to me, I guess. Sometimes, you know, we see these four walls and it's just us and we think, oh, I wish they could know what
doing a great thing in the earth. You know, it's making people, like it's been said, bolder and more appreciative and just more aware of what he's doing all the time, what he's making us to be. We can step up and be his instruments and be about his business. And I just thank God that we have, I'd say a great God, but that just kind of minimizes.
Yeah.
He's beyond great, you know.
Yeah.
He's beyond what you can think. And I just praise God that he's so awesome and he's making us more like him, which is a tremendous thing.
Yes.
Yes.
Amen.
Thank the Lord for Ember, our new granddaughter, being born yesterday. Everything went great. Mama and baby are doing well. And down in North Carolina, as the revival fire is now coming into that state, they named her appropriately as Ember. I pray the fire of God be on her and on her life and manifesting through her. Speak a blessing over her for God and his word, for his kingdom and his glory.
Amen.
Amen.
James.
These people that are in the world would just take a minute of realizing how negative they are and trying to tell people and focus on the positive and not act so. I think they're so prideful out there. I've seen that on TV and it's like, why can't you guys think of the positive stuff rather than worrying about the negative? I mean, if you guys act that way, you can relax.
one thing that I can tell you, Michael, is this. I was where you are. And God took me out of that. I spent 3 years in a difficult place, but the moment that I started coming here and I told them to guide me, that's when things started to change. So it's going to be okay. All right, well, let's stand and let's come to the Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Father, we thank you tonight for bringing us here, gathering your name. We thank you, Lord, for all the testimonies, all the praise, all the prayers that have been brought to you, Lord. Your people are reaching out to you. And we know, Father, that you're moving. You are moving in every situation in all of our lives, Father. We thank you for doing that. We thank you, Lord, because you never abandon us. You never leave our side. You always welcome us with open arms. We thank you, Father, because you give us your word, a word that we know that is true, a word that we know is going to manifest in all of our lives as we continue to declare it and speak it over ourselves and over others that come to us. Thank you for giving us the opportunity to pray for each other, for giving us the opportunity to come here, Father, and gather in your name where we know that we come completely dependent on you for you to move and manifest in our lives in the way that you want to manifest, Lord. The way that you change our lives for the better. That you turn us into new creatures every day, Lord. A new beginning every day. We receive your Holy Spirit. Your Holy Spirit that lives inside of us and manifests and gives us the revelation of your word. We thank you, Father. Because you're good. We know that you are good. Showing us that we can take a step of faith, Lord, and walk into the path that you have laid in front of us. That we can boldly come to you, Father, fearing no judgment, no condemnation, Lord, because we are in you. Thank you, Lord, for giving us your only Son, for the ultimate sacrifice of dying on the cross for us, and that we be reconciled to you, Father.
Yes, Lord.
We thank you, Lord, for your goodness. Giving us this opportunity to be here and pray for each other and praising you, Father, giving you all the praise and glory, lifting you up, Lord. Thank you, Lord, because we know that you're moving in this place right now and the revival is happening right now. Thank you, Father, for answering the prayers of all of those that have been praying either for a second or for years. Because we know, Lord, that everything that happens in our lives happens in your time, which is perfect. We thank you, Lord, for giving us this opportunity. We ask that you continue to give us the boldness to go out into this world and speak of who you are to those that come in our path. Thank you, Father, for filling us with your Holy Spirit and guiding us as we go. Please turn your cell phones off. And then this Friday, we're having our Easter Gatehouse prayer. What are we doing?
Coming after him, coming to listen to him, coming to release the kingdom that is within us to those that are coming in need, praying for each other, praying for our leadership, praying for this region, the city,
yes.
Iowa, this country,
yes.
Israel, and the world. I mean,
yes.
You name it, it's on.
Praise the Lord.
Okay, and then is it going to be a 24-hour?
No, it's a 12-hour, 9 a.m. to 9 p.m.
Okay.
It's a prayer burn up at Ankeny, up at Heartland Church. It's the Kingdom House of Prayer, non-denominational gathering. Same situation. Go after God. We're going to release. One of the things that they've told us, and we've been blessed with the worship team that we have, that they enjoy. before the last 2 hour run, because all through the day they've been praying, they've been pushing and stuff like that, and they say, well, we commit and we are in unity with the Lord, with the Spirit stuff, it ramps up the rest of the time.
Praise the Lord.
It just stokes the fire. So yeah, they get excited when the Lord works through us. So I praise the Lord for that. So if you can come and be a part, pray with us. One time we even released people off the platform to go out and pray for people. Remember that? And that was awesome. These guys are freaked out, but they're getting touched by God. They're getting touched by God. So don't rule anything out. Y'all come up. Y'all part of this ministry. If you're led to come up with us and stuff like that, stay with us, worship with us and stuff. And as the Lord leads you, just go on out and just start praying. It's a house of prayer. It's not a house of, you know, just standing around and doing this and that.
Yeah.
It's a house of prayer. So whatever it takes.
Praise the Lord.
So.
Amen.
All right. Well, let's speak the word tonight. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction of this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the Word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of His servants, and Abraham's blessings are mine.
I've been hearing since I got here is the Lord saying, it's on. Lord, I want some of it on me. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
You are. can feel your mighty power. It's moving in this place.
Yes, Lord.
This is the realm of your glory. This is the realm of your grace. I can feel your mighty power, and it's moving in this place. La da da, la da da, la da da, la da da.
Oh.
Praise God. Let's just embrace His presence right now in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, I know that we don't have to feel anything, but I also know, Lord, that you have been touched by the feelings of our infirmities, and you know what it means to us to literally feel your presence at times. And I thank you, Jesus, for that. I thank you, Lord, for the intimacy that you offer to each of us, Lord. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your embrace tonight, Lord. And we thank you, Lord, for every good and perfect gift. Thank you, Lord, for your steadfastness, your faithfulness. And I thank you, Lord, for what you're doing in this service and what you'll continue to do in the lives of these people throughout the coming weeks. I thank you, Lord, that you are a God of the now.
Yes.
And whatever we're dealing with now, Lord, you're there with us in the midst of it.
Yes.
Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you for victory, Lord. Yes. We celebrate it tonight, Lord. Right now, we celebrate the victory. It is finished, Lord. Yes. Thank you for it. We bless your name, Lord, the name above every name.
Yes.
And in that name we pray. Amen. Praise the Lord. Give the Lord a hand clap tonight. Thank the Lord. Praise God. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you all for being here tonight. Hope that you had a good 4th of July. And congratulations to all the grandpas. I mean, I just happened to have had a great granddaughter here just a couple of months back. Not quite even 2 months yet, has it been? We're looking at 2 grandparents there, praise the Lord. But grandkids are great, hallelujah. And great-grandkids are even greater, praise the Lord. Figure it out for yourself. But I always tell them it's because grandkids are the reward we get for not killing our children. Praise the Lord. Amen. There was a couple of times I was really close, praise the Lord, but amen. God is good. Hallelujah. Well, praise the Lord. Thanks again, everybody, for sharing your testimonies and prayer requests. It's a privilege to be able to share those with you and for all of us to be able to enter into these situations and allow the Holy Spirit to minister as only He can. Amen. And we just have to believe. We just have to receive it and believe and stand on it and continue to confess, amen, what God is doing and what God has already accomplished. Amen. So, I'm going to, obviously, again, it's Wednesday night, so I'll be brief, but let's move right into this. This is not a complicated message by any means, and although I don't think any of mine are, because I'm not that complicated, praise the Lord. You can ask my wife. Amen. All right, but let's get started. We'll go right to Hebrews chapter 12, and we're going to read Hebrews 12, verses 2 and 3 to begin with. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him that endured such contradiction of sinners against himself, lest ye be wearied and faint in your minds. But let me just look at this briefly here. I'm not going to get too involved, but just to say that we're looking unto Jesus. He's the author and the finisher of our faith. Our faith is in his faith, basically, and what the faith that he exercised to do what he did. Amen? So he's the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Okay, so Jesus did it all. Now he's seated. It's finished, right? He's not working any longer. It's done, right? So he says, consider him that endured such contradiction of sinners against himself, lest ye be wearied and faint in your minds. It's an invitation to rest with Jesus. We are seated with him in heavenly places. Okay? It's telling us the work finished. It's time for us to consider what he's done and the fact that he is now seated and resting, that we should do the same thing, that we should be resting in what Christ has done. Instead of striving, instead of struggling, instead of being paranoid and all burnt out and frustrated, we need to relax and rest in what he has done. Now, I know that's easier said than done, obviously, because we all struggle with anxiety and worries and fears from time to time. But I'm saying that's what we have to have our focus is on Jesus in order to do this. It won't happen any other way. Okay? All right, now quickly, let's go to Luke chapter 9 and verse 23. And he said to them all, "If any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me." Now, we need to read that in the context of what we've already read and what we already know about grace, about what Jesus has accomplished, the gospel of grace. He is the spirit of grace. In fact, he is grace personified. He's the human form of whatever we would define grace to be. And he said to them all, "If any man will come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me." So to take up your cross is not to sacrifice. It's not a sacrifice on our part. That's not what he's asking for. Amen? It's to deny self. Praise the Lord. How many know self is our issue? It's like Charlie Brown, "I've met the enemy and he's me," or "he's us," you know? And that's the problem. Self is our biggest problem.
Yes, it is.
Amen? Our spirit man is created in Christ. It's perfect in Jesus. It's totally accepted by God. It's fine. Amen? Our self, though, is another issue. Because in the context of what we're reading here, we're talking about our flesh. We're talking about the mind and body, the struggles that we have. Amen? So we're to deny that. Amen? See? Take up your cross. In other words, focus on Jesus and deny the self. The focus on the finished work of Jesus every day is our cross to bear, if you want to call it a cross. That's the only battle we've got, is to stay focused on that finished work. Praise the Lord, and rest in it. All right, Galatians chapter 2, verses 20 and 21. "I'm crucified with Christ." So if you take that other scripture we were talking about in any other context, this doesn't make much sense. So, "I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not frustrate the grace of God, for if righteousness come by the law, then Christ is dead in vain." So if you're trying to struggle to take up your cross, if that's your interpretation of that, then grace has been offered in vain. It's not going to do you any good.
Exactly.
Praise the Lord. Okay, 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 25. "Because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men." Now, that's a scripture that really messes with my mind. There's a lot of them that do. But this is one in particular. "Because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men."
Yeah.
Now, I call that a paradox. Yeah. And not because I've just invented that word, but because that's what it means. I mean, this is paradoxical. Amen? There's a weakness that comes from God, which is difficult to understand in the first place. But that weakness that comes from God is stronger than any strength that we have. There's a foolishness that comes from God, which is, you know, makes not much sense, but there's a foolishness that comes from God that is wiser than the wisdom that we have. But here's where it comes to an apex, or here's where it comes to the point that makes sense out of it. And that is, there was one thing in which the weakness and the foolishness of God found full expression, and that's the cross.
Yes.
Because it blew the mind of the wisest in this world.
Mm-hmm.
Still does to this day. It messed up the devil. If he had known, if he had been as smart as God is at his dumbest, I know that sounds almost blasphemous, but you know, just to use the scripture, if he was just as smart as God is in his foolishness,
right,
he would have known what was going on.
Right.
And we'd be dealing with a whole different situation today. Praise the Lord. God triumphed over all the strength and all the wisdom of this world.
Yes,
in that one act.
Yes,
praise the Lord. And God is asking us to learn that kind of weakness and that kind of foolishness. It's called grace. Praise the Lord. If you think the cross was anything other than an act of grace, you've been misled. You're misinformed. It was the gift of God. It wasn't that just that God came in the flesh. He had to come in the flesh in order to do what he was going to do, to bring grace by dying for all of our sins.
Mm-hmm.
Praise the Lord. Galatians chapter 3, verse 1. David said one place in Psalms, he said, I'm wiser than all my teachers. And that can be true of every one of us. Because if you could ever grasp what has been accomplished through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, you already know you're smarter than most people. You can go to university and listen to theology professors and so many others who know stuff, who have intellectual grasp, but have never really understood the reality of what's taken place. They may have wisdom as the world sees it, but it's just foolishness as far as God's concerned.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. So, O foolish Galatians, who hath bewitched you that you should not obey the truth, before whose eyes Jesus Christ hath been evidently set forth, crucified among you? So here it is. They've operated in the wisdom of God, but now they've gone back to the foolishness of man. They were saved by grace, but now they're operating in the foolishness of, it's my responsibility now to make this thing work.
Right.
Foolish Galatians, who's bewitched you? You should not obey the truth, before whose eyes Jesus has been evidently set forth crucified among you. Amen. All right, Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 7. I mean, when you say foolish Galatians, that's foolish.
Right.
That's just bad news. Amen. Hallelujah. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God. All right, so let's let this mind be in us, all right, because we're now born again. We're created in the image of God. We have been declared the righteousness of God in Christ.
Right.
And that's just a few little things. But let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men. Now, can you see our lives are in complete and specific contrast to this? Praise the Lord. Jesus, I'm talking about, when I say our lives, I'm talking in general terms of religious people, Christians, you know. So when Jesus was entitled to equality with God, because he is God in the flesh, right? So he had a right to see himself as equal with God. It was his divine nature, was it not? He didn't grasp at it. Lucifer wasn't entitled to equality with God. He was a created being. But he did grasp at it. And he fell. The decisive point of the difference between grasping and yielding is the difference between religion and grace. Praise the Lord. It's where we struggle. Now, you know, I'm not saying, you know, we're trying to be God or we're trying to be equal to God. But when we think we can do the things that it took God to do, you understand what I'm talking about? I'm talking about dealing with our sin, with our fallen nature, right? Our separation from God. we are like the foolish Galatians. So instead of grasping for this, God's telling us to yield to it.
Yes.
Now, it may sound like a fine line, but that's the difference between religion and relationship.
Yes.
It's the difference between grace and law.
There you go.
2 Peter chapter 1, verses 2 through 4. 2 Peter 1, verses 2 through 4. Grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and Jesus our Lord, according as his divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness through the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and virtue, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these you might be partakers of the divine nature.
Yes.
God is not withholding this any more than it was from Jesus. But we don't have to grasp it. It's given to us by these precious promises.
Yes. Yes.
We don't have to work at it. We have to yield to it.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. Does it look like we've escaped? Not necessarily, because we're still in the world. We're just not of the world. But as far as God's concerned, we've escaped the death. Corruption means dying, death. We're alive to God. We are no longer separated from God and corrupt or corrupting. We are now alive, quickened, amen, by his Spirit, because we have received his divine nature. And we receive it by these promises, not by what we do. We don't grasp for it. We yield to it. Praise the Lord. This isn't about working. This isn't about grasping or struggling. This is about resting. It's about yielding to what God has already done, to the finished work. And I just say, as we grow in this, we'll learn that that's true of every area of our life, whether it's healing, whether it's deliverance, whether it's whatever it is. We have struggled for healing when we should just be receiving it. Now, I know that's easy. Again, easier said than done. It has to become revelation, and that's why we keep going over and over and over, and I think that's why faith comes by hearing and hearing by the Word of God. You know, you could read it and hear it and hear it, but until it becomes revelation, nothing really changes. It's just information. It's just more information. I'm not being, you know, like judgmental or critiquing who is or who isn't. I just know in myself, I know some stuff, but it isn't all revelation. Because I'm not walking in all of it. You know what I mean? I haven't gotten to the place where it's a natural reality for me. I still have to focus. I still have to. It isn't second nature, you know. But it should be.
Yes.
And that's what we have to. That's what we're. If there's something to strive, it's to enter into his rest, isn't it?
Yes.
If you labor, if we're going to labor, let's labor to enter into his rest, not to work ourselves to death over something we can't produce.
That's right.
Hallelujah. Amen. And here, this just, I'll just put this out there, but I just honestly believe the day of God's individual man or woman of faith and power and those types of things that we've seen in the past, I think it's over.
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
Come on.
And that's why we try to do things the way we do here. I typically don't just go and pray for people or make special, you know, like, come to me and I'll set you free. But we're all on the same page here. I mean, we're all anointed. We all have the same anointing. We all have the same Jesus. We all have the same potential. It's just a question of us acting on that. And that's why, you know, really the job is more about empowering than it is about grasping power or trying to have power over people, but it's to release what is the truth of God's word to empower everybody so that we can literally be what it is God called us all to be. And I'm just, to be quite honest with you, I get a little frustrated when I watch some Christian TV and it's all about some guy or some woman, and it's just, you just limit God to be able to act through a couple of people instead of thousands maybe, you know, which is what he wants to do,
right.
Is to be tangible and visible in some way through every one of us as believers. Amen?
Amen.
And we just have to realize God works in different ways at different times. Now, God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. But he doesn't do everything the same. Jesus said it himself. He's going to do a new thing.
Right.
He's been doing new stuff all along.
Yep.
It's not new to God.
No.
Because he's always in the now.
Exactly.
Right.
But it is new to us. And that's why, you know, I thank God for every revival that has ever taken place. But I'm not looking to see a repeat of Brownsville or Azusa Street or Toronto or you pick one. Hey, I'm looking for a move of God.
Amen.
And I don't care how he does it. I just want to be there. I just want to be part of it. I just want to experience it. And I think he's just as apt to do it right here as he is anyplace else. That's not to say I wouldn't try to discourage anybody from going where there is a move of God taking place. I'm not saying that at all.
Right.
I'm just saying that what we have always called revival, you know, we need to redefine the word, but the truth is wherever God shows up, people are going to get revived.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. And that's all we're looking for. Amen. Oh. We're just looking for God to move, and if he does that, he's going to do it through people who know how God moves.
Come on, there you go.
Praise the Lord. So he just doesn't go on forever doing the same thing the same way.
No.
And some people are just not prepared to accept that.
That's right.
They find a success formula, something that has worked, and then they just keep on keeping on till it works to death.
Yeah.
It's like beating a dead horse. I've read books on top of books on top of books from the time that I was ordained in a particular organization. I read everything I could get my hands on because I wanted it.
Yes.
Amen. And what I found out was we had miracles taking place right where we were in a small church. That was revival.
Yes.
Yeah.
That was an awakening.
Come on. Yes.
People were actually seeing God.
Come on.
And I got frustrated because I thought if it wasn't thousands, then something was wrong. Praise the Lord. But our definitions are foolishness to God. Praise the Lord. Now, it may sound like I'm trying to cop a plea here, but I'm not. I'm just saying whatever God wants to do is okay with me.
Yep.
Praise the Lord. And because I'm not going to produce revival.
Right.
I'm just going to participate, you know.
Exactly.
If it happens, it'll be God. And it will happen because we have promises that it will.
Yes.
But the way it'll happen is when everybody
Amen.
Is in one mind
yes.
and
yes.
one accord.
Yes.
And the Spirit just has a free flow through each of us. We see it. We see glimpses of it in the testimonies.
Yes.
You begin to hear witnesses, you know, from
yes.
one situation to another situation. That's what I'm talking about. That releases God. When everybody, I'm not saying we have totally perfect continuity in everything that we believe and see and do, but I'm saying we are all looking for God. We're all looking for God to move, for God to manifest.
Mm-hmm.
We believe that he will. We have expectation that he will, and he will.
Yes.
So you can't put a preconceived idea about how that will happen, or you may miss it when it does happen.
Come on.
Exactly.
Come on. If you think I'm just talking, everybody had been praying for the consolation of God to come to the earth. They were looking for revival, believe me.
Yes.
And it showed up right in their face, and they hung him. And then they crucified him
right.
and beat him.
Right.
Praise the Lord. So, you know, anyway. I'm not looking for a formula. I'm just looking for Jesus. Praise the Lord.
Yes.
Psalms chapter 51, verse 6. Because when God does it, you'll know it's God.
That's right.
Amen.
Ooh, amen.
Praise the Lord. He does all things well. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Behold, thou desirest truth in the inward parts, and in the hidden part thou shalt make me to know wisdom. Praise the Lord. Behold, Thou desirest truth in the inward parts, and in the hidden part thou shalt make me to know wisdom. Amen. All right, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 7. And I might just throw this out there for your consideration, but I think truth in the inward parts is revelation. Mm-hmm. It's not information. It really is revelation. It's something that changes you from the inside out. It connects with the Spirit. Amen. We speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world unto our glory. Now, I'm just getting off here a little bit, but let me just say this. Based on what I just said, that I believe the hidden wisdom is revelation, because it is the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world unto our glory. And also, when Jesus would teach his disciples, he was releasing revelation. They had lots of religion. They had a lot of information about religion, but they had very little revelation. That's why they didn't recognize him when he showed up. Amen. But when Jesus would teach in parables, if you ever noticed, he taught in parables for a reason. Because he wasn't trying to give more information. He was trying to give revelation.
Right.
Because he knew more information really wasn't going to do him any good. They had all the information they needed.
Yes.
Right.
They had the whole Torah. They had the Old Testament. But it really wasn't doing a whole lot of good. So he was trying to release revelation. And the secret place, the secret wisdom, secret knowledge, are all these things he's talking about. And if a thing is a secret, it's hidden, right?
Right.
It's out of sight. It's not something you can just see easily. So if we want to dwell in the secret place, if we want to find the secret wisdom, revelation, in other words, then we have to be willing to be hidden. Praise the Lord. I thought that would go over about like that. Praise the Lord. If we want to dwell in the secret place, if we want to have the secret wisdom, revelation, then we've got to be willing to be hidden. Now, I don't mean that like we, you know, withdraw to a cave somewhere or, you know, hide out. I'm saying we have to rest in Christ. We have to be in Christ. Praise the Lord. That's the hidden mystery. It's Christ in you, the hope of glory. It's that we have to learn that this isn't about us. It's about Him. And we need to rest in the finished work of Christ in order to see the revival that God really wants. Because God wants the glory. Men have been getting the glory for a long time. Locations have been getting glory. All kinds of things have been getting, but God wants the glory.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. So if we want to dwell in that place, then we have to be hidden. And that's why he says we are crucified with Christ. He said, yet I live. But then it's like a second thought comes to him and he goes, wait a minute. It's not me that's living.
Exactly.
It's Christ in me.
Yes.
You understand what I'm saying now about the hidden? I'm not trying to say we become invisible. I'm saying this is about the focus on Jesus.
Yes.
For us personally and for the people that we come into contact with.
Yes.
That it's not about me and my ministry or this or that. It's about Christ and Him crucified.
Amen.
And the fact that we have this revelation that we want to share. Praise the Lord. And the only way we can do it is by getting out of the way.
Exactly.
So that the Holy Spirit can do what He wants to do.
Exactly.
Praise God. Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 through 4. See, when we quit worrying about us and start focusing on Jesus, people will see more of Jesus than they see of us.
Come on.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. If ye then be risen with Christ, right? We're crucified, but we live. Yet it's not us that lives, but it's Christ that lives in us. So we're resurrected. We're seated with Him in heavenly places. If we're risen with Christ, then seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God, which is what? The finished work. That's why He's seated.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. We're not seeking to accomplish or to produce something. We're seeking to rest in the finished work.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes.
We're we're seeking to have the revelation that it is literally done, and all we have to do is yield to it.
Yes.
Praise God. Otherwise, we're frustrating grace.
Exactly.
We're not letting it do what it's supposed to do, praise the Lord, which is to produce healing, deliverance, amen, people being born again, all those things. So set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. For you are dead, and your life is what? Hid with Christ in God.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Find a hiding place.
Yes.
Hallelujah. It's a safe place, praise the Lord. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then you shall also appear with him in glory.
Yes.
Ooh, I got goosebumps right now. I'm telling you, when the miracle, when the supernatural takes place, amen, God is revealed.
Yes.
But the fact that God is in us is revealed at the same time.
Exactly.
It's about revealing him, but it also reveals Christ in us, the hope of glory. It makes us valid. It makes us relative. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Let me just get off here for a moment. When Abraham was called out of Ur of the Chaldees, he was called to come out from everybody. In other words, God was saying, trust me. I want you to trust me. I'm going to send you to a place that you don't know about. It's kind of cool. I love that. I want you to take off, and I'm sure Abraham was thinking, where? And just go. You'll eventually get there. I'm gonna get you there.
Yeah.
But I'm not giving you a map, and I'm not giving you the name of the town, and I'm not giving you the location. I'm just saying go. Get away from everybody. All the idolatry, all of the mess that was in that the Chaldeans were involved in. Amen. But he didn't do that. He took his father, and he took his nephew. And most likely he took a bunch of other people who were servants and who, you know, were his band of brothers, you know, not family, but people that were connected with him,
right.
Support system,
sure.
In other words. Amen? And so he goes and he's going to a secret place that God's going to show him, but he doesn't know where it is.
Right.
Because he's still depending on everything but God. You see my stretch here for a metaphor, but I'm just saying, that's where we're at. That's what we struggle with. Because Abraham didn't really trust God's intention.
Come on.
He operated in his own strength and his own abilities.
Yes.
And the support system that he had intact, right?
Right.
Father, nephew, so forth. All right, look at this in Genesis chapter 13, verses 14 and 15. The Lord said unto Abram, after that Lot was separated from him, now his father had already died and been buried some time back, but Lot was still there and all of his people as well as Abram's and his. And so he says, lift up now, after Lot was separated from him, he said, lift up now thine eyes and look from the place where thou art, northward, southward, eastward, and westward. For all the land which thou seest, to thee will I give it, and to thy seed forever. That was Abram's inheritance, right? But God didn't reveal it till Abram yielded to grace. As long as he was still trying to produce, to get to have with Lot, with his father, with his servants, with whatever it was, he didn't find it. He didn't find the hidden place. He didn't find the secret place. But the moment that was gone, God said, just open your eyes and look around. It's all yours. This is your inheritance. Praise the Lord. All right, Genesis 15 and verse 1. This is the last scripture. We'll wrap here. Genesis 15 and verse 1. Now, this is after Lot and them were all captured and taken off, and he had already gone to Sodom, but then these other kings came, attacked, and took them prisoner, and all of the stuff and everything, you remember? And then Abram took his servants and went out and defeated those kings and took back all of the spoils, everything they already had, plus all the stuff that they had taken from them, released the prisoners, and he comes back, and this is where he meets the type of Christ, the Melchizedek, the high priest, you know, so forth, who offers up communion. But here, after these things, the word of the Lord came unto Abram in a vision, saying, "Fear not, Abram, I am thy shield and thy exceeding great reward." Now, what had happened? Abram had defeated these people because God was with him, and he knew that. He shouldn't have beaten them. They were armies, they were kingdoms, and so forth. But he did, and he brought back all of this spoil. And then he comes to this type of Christ, which is Melchizedek, without beginning, without end, high priest forever. So he interacts with him, and he gives him everything. Take it all. I don't even want a shoelace. Nothing. I don't want anything. I'm trusting God. See what I'm saying? He had learned something from that experience where God said, "This is yours."
Right.
So he instead of saying, "Man, I can get fat off of this. You know, this is good. I got lots of money here. This is going to be good." But he didn't. He gave it all back. Said, "I don't want any of it. Split it up amongst yourselves, however you want to do it, but I don't want any of it." And then God's response is, "Fear not. I am thy shield and thy exceeding great reward." Now I know some of you have heard this before, but I'm going to just share it just for the sake of sharing it because it's important to me. When I first got back in the ministry after resigning after dropping my license with the organization I was in because of I couldn't continue to preach everything that they were telling me I had to preach in order to stay in their organization, so I just got out and was back in the secular world stuff for a while. And when we came back in, when I took this church, and it was out in a trailer park over on the south side in a community building, and I prayed about it. I won't go through the whole thing, but anyway, the Lord spoke to us and said, "Yeah, this is what we need to do." Sally agreed, so we did. I quit the job that I had and went back full time to this. Now I got to tell you, we didn't have any income, and at that time what income came in off the church was eaten up immediately by the rent and the utilities. Anybody that was out there remembers that building was like being in a screened-in porch year-round because there was insulation, zero. So it cost hundreds of dollars a month just to heat and cool it, and there weren't that many people there to begin with, so there wasn't really any income at all. And I was praying about that to the Lord because the Lord had told me specifically the time before when I had pastored a home missions church, we started a church, got into a building and some other things, moved on along. But I was working a full-time job as well as pastor in the church because there wasn't enough income from the church to keep the cost of the church going. So this time I prayed about it, and that's what the Lord said, "Either you're going to trust me or trust the world." So I trusted him, and I was in a long prayer meeting with him one time over there on the south side, and I was just, feeling sorry for myself and freaking out, and what am I going to do? I got bills from a, $100,000 a year income, the bills are the same, but now I got zero income. Well, what's the chances of this working out real well? But so I was freaking out, and I was trying to think, and I'm not going to say we didn't ever do anything, because we did. We had a few little, I'm talking about little jobs. We were cleaning up construction sites and stuff like that just to keep, just in the interim. But this is the scripture that the Lord gave me. If you'll trust me, is basically what he told me. I'll be your shield and your exceeding great reward. And I can tell you, before God, that has been the truth. Doesn't mean I don't have times, throughout the year where I go, "Whoa, this is not going to be real easy." But it's your problem, God, because you're my shield and my exceeding great reward. You put yourself on the spot for this deal, so, it's on you. And I can honestly say, and Sally will tell you the same thing, he's never let us down. It's gotten close where it looked like maybe he forgot, but he never has. Amen. And he's not a respecter of persons. He's not doing this for me because I'm his, man of the new millennium or something. Just another believer that's just trying to trust him.
Exactly.
And that's what he wants. That's a secret place. That's a hidden place. That's a place where nothing can get to you.
Exactly.
He's your shield. Believe me, they're not going to get past God's shield.
That's right.
And he's our exceeding great reward. I'll take that over a bank account. I'll take that over, extended credit. I'll take that anytime, anywhere, under any circumstances.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah. When we take up the cross, we're focusing on Jesus. It's not about what I can do or can't do. If this had been left up to me over the last 10 or 12 years, I wouldn't be here. I'd be back working somewhere else because I couldn't have done it. Amen. But when you trust God,
Amen.
You take up your cross
Amen.
And you follow Jesus.
Yes.
What did Jesus say? I don't do anything except what I see my Father do. I don't say anything except what I hear my Father say.
Amen.
That's following Jesus.
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
Praise
the Lord. Amen. Deny ourselves. Quit looking to you for the ability and start focusing on Him who has already accomplished everything.
Amen.
Our ability, our strength, our self-righteousness, we need to deny that and focus on the finished work.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. God reveals it when you yield to His grace. Praise the Lord. There's things everybody here is looking for. And they're not wrong things. But you're not going to produce it. And the sooner you relax and yield to the finished work of the cross, the sooner it's going to be revealed. The sooner you're going to experience that secret place. Hallelujah. His strength is made perfect in our weakness. He is our shield and our exceeding great reward. Nothing to fear. Nothing can get past that shield. And I'll tell you, when God rewards,
yes.
It's super abundant. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
He wants to pour out blessings. He wants to reward in ways that we can't even imagine.
Exactly.
Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Pour out blessings. Exceeding abundantly above all that you can ask or think.
Yes.
Hallelujah. And he's just saying, quit struggling. Start yielding.
Yes.
And see your inheritance.
Yes.
Give the Lord a hand clap. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. I recognize that it's one thing to say it and another thing to do it. But how it's done is simply believing the promises. Gives you the divine nature. You don't have to grasp for it. Just yield to it and watch it produce. Hallelujah. Amen. God bless all of you. Appreciate you again being here tonight. Look forward to seeing you back here Sunday. Have a great rest of your week. God bless you all. You're dismissed in Jesus' name.